Seated. Wow. Thank you for being here at Honey Lake Church this morning. What a great day to worship God today. How many first-time visitors do we have here today? Any? Ah, excellent. Let's give them a big Honey Lake welcome. Thank you so much for being here. You know, you could have been anywhere today, but you chose to be here with us worshiping the living God, and we just thank you for that. When you came in, you should have gotten a connection card. If you would please fill that out for us and put it in the offering plate when it comes around later. We're not going to hassle you, but we do want to get to know you. We do want to build a relationship. We want to let you know what's going on here at Honey Lake. We always have a lot of exciting things going on. We want to pray for you if you have any needs. We won't show up on your doorstep unless you ask us. If you ask us, we'll come visit you and pray for you. But we just thank you for being here. If you're just passing through or already a member of another church, we thank you for being here as a visitor. If you're looking for a home church, this is a good one. We welcome you to come every Sunday. We're here helping build the kingdom of God here in this area. So we thank you for being here. If you have a cell phone, if you would turn that off or put it on mute during the service, we'd appreciate that. Did anyone get up and see the lunar eclipse on Wednesday? Anybody? 6:30? Yeah, okay, we got a few. It was pretty interesting. I got to see the first part of it, and it was gorgeous, and then fog came in. I don't know how it was at your house, but it just went to total eclipse, and I never got to see it come back out because it was fogged in. But if you remember, if you're with us at Easter, we were talking about we're living in a very interesting time biblically, and that there are four blood moons, a lunar eclipse of blood moon, and we've got four of them that are falling on Jewish holidays. The first one's Passover. This one fell in Feast of Tabernacles. We've got another one in the spring, another one in the fall. And it's called a triad. And this has only happened seven times in 2,000 years. And we're right in the middle of the seventh one. And every time this happens, interesting things happen, particularly the nation of Israel, but it impacts the whole earth. So it's a very interesting time we're living in. And you know, when there's interesting times, there's pressure, isn't it? And when there's pressure, people feel it, and they end up and they say, boy, I'm like this because of my circumstances. But you know what I found out in my life? Any time in my life, wherever I'm at, it's because of my decisions. It's not because of my circumstances, it's because of my decisions. And in interesting times, I'm thankful that I've given my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ and made that decision. And so I just want you to think about that during the service. We've got a great service, but we'll have an opportunity. If you've never made that decision, it's a good day to do it. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. And there's nothing better than to worship the Lord when things are going on in the earth. Okay, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for a wonderful, glorious day. For each family and each person here, we thank you that you're going to move on their hearts and change their lives today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Charlie. Let's all stand as we do this next worship song together. Blessed be your name.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be your name.
All right, you may be seated. At this time, we have a very, very special guest. I'd like to introduce her. Her name is Sheila Doyle, and she has wonderfully, willfully come out to bless us with song today. Let's welcome Sheila Doyle.
Thank you. Hopefully it'll be a blessing to you.
God of all,
said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. That was awesome. Has anybody in here think you can become a world champion? Show of hands. Kim? Well, you know, it's an amazing thing what the Bible teaches about what we can accomplish. Philippians 4:13 is my favorite life's verse. It says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, you think about that. It doesn't say, now that I'm a Christian, Christ will do everything for me. It says, I can do. So that tells us that we have to put in the effort, use our experience and our intellect and whatever we've got to try to make it happen. And we get it as far as we can, and then God takes over and does the rest. Well, what is all things? Does it really mean all things? No. Because if I wanted to establish a drug cartel, God's not going to bless that. It's all things within God's will for your life. So anybody in here has the capacity to accomplish all things within God's will for your life. That could be a world champion water skier like Kristi. Or it could be a lot of things. Excellent singer like Sheila, or a brain surgeon. I don't know that I'm going to make it to the brain surgeon part, and you'll probably be glad that I didn't. But seriously, Abraham didn't think that he would ever have a son, but he did. And God told him that he would. So we have to have a certain amount of faith, but we also have to put in the effort. I talked with some guys this morning in Jerusalem by Skype who are setting up a meeting with the Jesus Alliance, which is what I'm representing, for me to meet the Pope. Can you imagine that? I didn't ever think I'd be meeting the Pope, but the Pope's very interested in seeing the church unified after so many thousands of years, beginning in Ephesus. Doesn't mean everybody's going to agree on everything, but the thing that the Pope said, he wanted unity. And one thing for sure, that we can only receive justification through our faith and through the grace of God, where Jesus died on the cross, and not by works. However, if you are justified, you will have works. So anyway, I just want to encourage you this morning, particularly young people, don't think that you can't accomplish things. You can look at my life. There was very, very little chance for me to do much of anything but die or go to prison or something. But I was able to go beyond that, and now it's an entirely different thing. It's through God and through our faith in God, but we also have to do our part. And I met Kristi in a prison. She wasn't in prison. But she was doing prison ministry. And my wife and Cindy, a couple of people in our church, for the very first time ever went to that ministry, and they were just wonderfully impressed by her story and how she worked so hard and to become a world champion, as you know, from all the Olympics and everything that you watch. It doesn't just happen overnight. It's just hour after hour of grueling practice and pain, working through the pain of injuries and so forth. So she was able to do that in an astounding way. I've water skied myself. I know how hard it is and to do what she can do. And but what she has done is taken that testimony and started a ministry, and now she's going to start taking it into prisons. She's going to take her boat in there and minister to prisoners. And it's amazing. There were many people that were saved because of her testimony. So I think that if you really just give her your full attention, it's Kristi Overton Johnson. I think they're going to show a video first, right, Kristi? So we welcome her here at Honey Lake.
Set by Kristi Overton, 4,770 points.
Kristi Overton, the reigning World Junior Girls Overall Champion. Overton is also the current World Junior Slalom and Jump Champion, certainly the best junior girls skier in the world, bar none.
Kristi enjoying slalom could spell bad news for her competitors. And easily, again, a solid run at 40 feet for Kristi. So the new kid on the block is done it, Wayne. Kristi Overton, on her first pro start, has won the championship of the women's slalom, beating out the veteran Dina Mapple. And Kristi, age 19, has reason to smile, and you'll see a lot of her on the pro tour throughout this summer.
Kristi comes in at 38 off, stroking the pass. Tight line, nice lean through the wakes, around number three, coming into number four. She's past Tony and Jill. She's coming into the lead territory, around five. She's not going to stand up. She wants to run this pass. And there's your winner, Kristi Overton, 6 at 38 off.
Here comes Kristi Overton at 35 off. On her home site. Here comes Kristi Overton. She needs to get past two buoys.
Wonderful start. A little slow, number two, but she didn't want to push it too much, and she's there.
Yeah. For Kristi Overton, skiing the best of her career right now. Recently engaged to be married. She says she wants the money, and she wants this Masters title.
Going for back-to-back titles as she gets all the way around number four. She does on her onside sails to victory and continues to have a very easy go at short line slalom.
Here's the magic run, tour title, and an event victory if she can get past four at 38 off.
Oh, good start. Look at this. Good tight line at number two. Oh, she's in great shape. And she's got four. There's the tie, and there's the win. She got around the fifth buoy, but she's going for more. She runs the whole pass.
God's allowed me to go through some trials the last few years. And it's nice to put yourself to the test and to get back where you were, and hopefully there won't be too many more tasks because I'm getting tired, but I just give him the glory for this. It's wonderful.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So
She was just fierce, and that's probably the best way to describe her. And now, even in her life after skiing, she's still incredibly fierce, but now she's really fierce for God.
And I think her desire to be number one on the water has led right into her desire in the ministry to be God's number one.
She took on the role of understanding that, you know, what she did on the water and what she has and what she's been given was all blessing from God. She found an opportunity, a blessing she had, to be able to reach people through water skiing, and being on the water was a way that she could build a bridge to connect to people.
That was a long time ago. It's just amazing to me when I watch that video that it's been, over 10 years. About 12 years since I won my last professional tour title and traveled across the world water skiing with my husband, Tim. Say hello. He's my better half. He was my boat driver. And we met, interestingly enough, because he had a lake and no boat, and I had a boat and no lake. So it was just a connection made in heaven. We kind of used each other for what we had. But we met. We met there at UCF. He was playing football there. I was on the water ski team. I had moved from North Carolina, which is why I have this twang. We had moved from there down to Florida for me to train, and that's where I met Tim. And that was many, many years ago, almost 25 years ago. We got married in 1994. Yeah, and moved up to the Gainesville area. I know we're in Tallahassee area here, but we were there. We went to law school at University of Florida, and we've been there for 20 years until a couple months ago when we moved to Clermont, Florida. And so we're kind of starting over there with our three kids. You saw Dalton, Ivy, and Ty on the screen there. Ty is 16 years old, and then we have two younger children. Dalton is 13 and Ivy is 12, and we adopted them from Russia 9 years ago. And so that's just a whole story in itself of how God moved in our life and just showed up in our life at that point. And he changed our relationship with him as we saw him do what only he could do. But we have an awesome family. We're there in Clermont just waiting on the Lord to show us exactly what he would have us do. But in the meantime, as you were saying, Mr. Bob, to just be busy about the Lord's business, telling people about him and loving people, more importantly, loving people to him. And so that's what our life is about. It's been quite a journey. Water skiing, at the age of 4, I was introduced to water skiing. My dad was what you would call a river rat. He loved to ski. We were in North Carolina on the Pamlico River. And that was just what he did growing up. And so at age 4, he tied my skis together, tied a rope to the skis, and off I went. I don't know that I had a lot of choice. I can't really remember. But I thought, and then after that, he began to bribe me with candy and toys and money. And I liked that too. So I got pretty good, pretty fast. And we were traveling all over the world. By the age of 13, I had turned professional. You saw some of the pictures when I was a little girl. This is what we did as a family. And it was just an amazing adventure. We've got a lot of ski clubbers here and people who love to ski. And it is such a great family sport that you go to the lake and you hang out there all day, encouraging one another to get up when you fall, celebrating the victories and spurring each other on through the defeats. And that's like with any sport. You saw the picture of me crashing. That was not the only one. There was a lot of agony of defeat, a lot of pain, as you were saying, that you just had to push through. But the thing about it is I loved it. Even though my dad would bribe me, I always tell him I would have done it without the toys, because it was something that I could go out and do and work hard at, but then see progress every day. There was always room for improvement. And my father was one who was very active. My mother was my coach. And then once we got in the sport really deep, it was very expensive. And my dad had to, you know, the businessman behind it, making it all possible, and built us our own lake called Lake Kristi in North Carolina. And I thought everybody had their own lake in their backyard. Now you do, Mr. Bob. But not everybody else does, and that's something I took for granted. I remember my dad and my mom meeting with neighbors in the area and some city officials, sharing the vision that they had for Lake Kristi, and people thought he was crazy. You're going to go get bulldozers and dig a lake and dam up this spring and this stream that ran through there. But that's what they did, and like Honey Lake, it is a gorgeous place outside of Greenville, North Carolina. Kind of interesting. And I didn't even know there was a Greenville, Florida. And we told my parents if they moved here, they'd see us a lot more because it's a lot closer than Greenville, North Carolina. But it was there that I skied constantly. And, you know, we would have coaches come and pour their knowledge into me. My mother was in the boat constantly with me, and I, as a mother now of three children, I am just amazed at the sacrifice that she made for me, and I'm so thankful. But what I am most grateful for isn't all the time on the water, although that provided a wonderful platform for my life today and for being able to minister to people. I learned so much, I had so many wonderful experiences, but I'm most thankful for the foundation of faith that they gave to me. I was raised in a Christian home, and if the church doors were open, we were there, and my parents made sure of it. Even when we'd go to ski tournaments, you know, we would often hold little services, and I remember, you know, as a little girl, we'd line up and sing Jesus Loves Me, you know, and the adults would just stand back as the little girls just led that, and it was just a wonderful atmosphere to grow up in. I had loving parents. I really don't have a testimony of drugs and alcohol and things, praise God. My testimony is I am a recovering perfectionist and a recovering people pleaser. And you know, whether it's drugs, whether it's alcohol, whether it's sexual addiction, whether it's being addicted to money and being successful, or whether it's having to be perfect, the perfect mom, the perfect athlete, the perfect daughter, the perfect wife, even though people aren't putting that pressure on you, that pressure that's within you to be somebody and please everybody, because that was my greatest goal, was for everybody to like me. And you can't have everybody like you and be who God made you to be, because everybody likes something different. And so that's really where I am. I am a recovering perfectionist and people pleaser, and I am not kidding. And it is a daily struggle for me to learn to say no and to learn to set boundaries and to give myself some margin and some grace, because, you know, people don't have to beat me up. I beat myself up because I want to be so successful. And so that's been my journey. And today I just want to share a little bit about my journey and how I ended up in prison with Mr. Bob and Kenny, and how I ended up here, because it has been quite a journey. And that's what I felt the Lord saying this week, is just share the journey, because being a Christian, it is about a journey. It's not you walk down the aisle one day, and today I pray some of you may not have ever made that decision. That is the start. That is like when I was 4 years old and I got off the dock as a water skier and I became a water skier. Today may be the day that you become a believer in Jesus Christ, but that's the start. But it took 30 years of me getting up every single day, pushing myself to be a world champion. And you know what's really amazing is in that 30-year time period, there wasn't perfection. In fact, every day that I went out there, I failed at some level. I failed learning a new trick. In the slalom course, you know, you see all those buoys, you're going around. As soon as you run six, they shorten the rope to make it harder. At some point, you're going to miss it. Sometimes earlier than you really wanted to, but at some point you're either going to crash, you're going to fall, or you're going to miss. And so, you know, during that 30 years, every single day at some point there was a miss and there was a disappointment. But what's amazing is even in the midst of all those falls and disappointments, I still became a world champion. And I just think that is such a powerful message. Whether you are a water skier, or whether you're sitting in prison, or whether you're sitting out here and you're thinking, man, I am so far from where I should be, whether that's spiritually, physically, with your weight, whatever it is, I feel so far away. When you walk the aisle, you don't just arrive at this place of perfection. It's this journey of life, of becoming more like Christ every single day. Some days are better than others. Last week, I had some really great godly days, and I'm really godly up until about 6:25, until all three kids come down to the table and they start fighting. And then I don't stay so godly for very long. And, you know, and then you can ask Tim Friday. You know, I was so excited about getting here. But then I've got a lot of company coming in and out of the house. And I was running around, as we say in the South, like a chicken with my head cut off. So anxious that I gave myself a migraine, a stomach ache. And I'm like, this isn't of the Lord. You know, I'm running around like a crazy woman. But does it mean that I'm not a believer and a Christian? No, it just means, you know what? I got to get back on track. I got here and I went to walk. And I just walked up and down the road and prayed and got myself back centered with the Lord, repented of the mistakes. And instead of beating yourself up over and over and over, let's get on with it. And that's what I'm finding in my Christian walk. You know, it used to be these big, I'd get up here and then I'd come way down here. And now it's more like this. I'll start to kind of dip, and then I start to think about what I'm thinking about. And I realize, you know what, these thoughts aren't of God. These actions, this sense of dis-ease in my spirit, that's not of the Lord. So I got to go to God, and I got to take care of this right now, where it used to stay there for a year. It used to put me in a hospital, literally, because I had 10 years of sickness. No one could find out what was wrong with me. You know, I had a lot of surgeries. I had 16 surgeries for other things. But the day-to-day sickness, chronic disease, they searched and searched. They said, you're the healthiest sick person we've ever met. And I did everything to keep myself healthy, except for protect my time and protect my mind. I was so anxious about doing for God. And you were talking about, I can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. Well, I'm a doer. I love to work. I mean, you give me a task and I'm going to go for it because I love to perform. It's what I did as a water skier. I love to get my hands dirty. I love to start something from scratch and to see something come to fruition. But for me, I can get so involved in working so hard that I forget that it is God who gives you the strength. It is God. And a lot of times I have gone and gone and gone and gone, and then gotten to the end of my rope, if you will, and I'm like, I did all of that by myself. You know, I never even asked God where he'd have me go. And that's where we are right now. God has said, you know what, you're gonna move, and you're gonna kind of start over, and we're gonna build on what the foundation is you already have, and this time it's gonna be in my strength. And there are days where I forget that. There's days when I get anxious and I just keep going and going. But, you know, I just want to encourage you today that that's all God's looking for, is someone who will just keep getting up in the morning and going in his strength and being willing to lay aside perfectionism about it having to be just right, and laying aside people pleasing. There's a difference between pleasing people and honoring people, respecting people and loving people. There's a big difference. God doesn't tell you to go out and please people. Paul says, if I tried to please man, I would not be a servant of God. But he does tell you to love man, and he tells you to honor one another and respect one another. And so that's where I am. That's the journey that I'm on, is finding that place of freedom where I am connected to the power source, just like I was connected to the boat. You know, That rope, you can't really tell it in the video, but when they're saying 38 off, that means just 38 feet off the rope. There's a 75-foot line. 39 feet. They've taken 39 feet off the rope. I was the first woman to ever run 39 off and to get into 41 off. At 41 off, the rope is 4 feet short of actually reaching the buoy. 4 feet. So you are literally, and all this is going on, you're going about 65 miles an hour behind the boat. The boat speed's 34, but you're just about doubling it to get around this buoy. And in 16.95 seconds, all of this is happening. You're going around six buoys. The rope's too short. You're accelerating to 65 miles an hour, down to about 20, and going again. And it's just amazing. But what's really cool is what the reason it's all possible is because you're tapped into this power source. I couldn't go ski myself around these buoys without the boat. And when I get in a body position where I am just, you saw it, just laid out behind the boat, not even pulling with my arms, because as soon as I try to insert my strength and I go like this, the boat pulls you up, you get off edge and you go flat and you miss the ball, or either you, worse, you go tumbling. So it's about getting in this position, tapping into that power of the boat and letting it do the work. And when you do that, and then you get out to this buoy and you say, you know what, I'm just going to let go. I'm going to have this faith. The impossible happens. And that's how it is with God. You tap into his strength. You just get focused on him and start bringing him into every area of your life. You see, I was raised with this priority system. God is first. Then it's, you know, your husband and your family and your ministry, and, you know, it would just go down this list. So I would get up in the morning, and to me, first meant go have my time with God. And that is a wonderful practice. But then I would leave God there at my kitchen table with my Bible, and then I'd go be a mom or I'd go be a wife. And what I realized is I was leaving God here. And I had studied, and I had been blessed that morning. I had prayed up. But then I went about my day in my own strength. Instead of being connected and intertwined with that power source who would give me the strength, give me the wisdom, give me the patience, give me the love and wisdom, discernment, all these things that I needed. So what I've learned is it's not God then these things, it's God in these things. You bring God into your business is going to be blessed. You bring God into your marriage is going to be blessed. You bring God into your water skiing, and he'll take something so simple and someone so ordinary, a woman that just ran around buoys, and he can use it to touch the world. And I love it in Timothy. It talks about in a house, there's all these utensils. There's styrofoam. It didn't say styrofoam in here. They didn't have styrofoam back there in the Babel days. But it does talk about this division of utensils. And they had wood, I think, for spoons. And they had glass. And then they talk about having silver and gold. These incredible utensils. And he says, you know, this wood and these things are used in glass. They're for everyday use. But then your gold and your silver, that's something special. And it says if you live your life for the Lord and you stay pure, that God can take ordinary things, these utensils that are used, and use them for a very special purpose. And I have really butchered that verse. But what it means is you take your ordinary thing, your ordinary life, the things that you do throughout the day, and you give them to God, and he will use them for a special purpose. Whether it's riding horses, whether it's skiing, whether it's football, whether it's being a mom, all these things, God will bring purpose to them and impact so that you leave a legacy that's not just about buoy count. You know, I've been out of that sport for a long time, but you leave a legacy where lives are touched for all eternity, for all eternity. For me, this journey with the Lord is bringing me to a place of freedom. When I skied, I put a lot of pressure on myself to succeed. I had been Kristi the skier since I was 4 years old. Everywhere I went in my town, It's a small town, Greenville, North Carolina. It's probably, I don't know, anywhere from 80 to 100,000 people. That's when the college is in. Then the college leaves and, you know, the population really goes down. But everywhere I went, I was Kristi the skier. There was billboards up for my dad's store, Overton's up, you know, on the streets, and you were in magazines and on the radio and TV. And then all of a sudden, in 1996, I couldn't ski anymore. I had a surprise surgery. I'd had one surgery that Christmas, and then during my pregnancy, I was still competing. I was studying for the bar, for the law school, and just going about my life in true Kristi mode, taking on everything I could. You know, a lot of you women are going, you were skiing and you were pregnant. Well, it's what everybody else did it. And they would go to about 24, 25 weeks. And that way you didn't lose your points on the tour. And that way you didn't lose your sponsors that were paying me money to ski. It was my livelihood. And so I had it all planned out. I was going to ski. I was going to take the bar. I was all these things, and I ended up in a hospital during the U.S. Open water ski tournament, which was being held at Lake Kristi, which was my home site. You know, you heard him say, she going to win on her home site. That was the lake my father built for me, and the entire town was coming out to see me. And all of a sudden, I'm hooked up to morphine, my new best friend, and laying there in this hospital. And I remember just watching the news and them talking about the competition and all these people there from all over the world there to compete. And here I was in the hospital. So I remember telling Tim, I kind of went to the bathroom and I pulled my pump in there and I got in a ski position just to see, Tim, if you take me out to the lake, I can push this pain out of my mind because I had done that my entire life. It's what athletes do. And I can ski. He never listens to me, and that's a good thing because he did not leave the hospital with me, didn't sneak me out to the lake. He left me there, and it wasn't much longer before they were operating, and I had this severe bowel obstruction. It was actually about 30 minutes, they said, from my intestines bursting. Most likely getting an infection that would have taken the life of my baby and possibly my life. But you know, at that time, all I was thinking about was buoys and my standings and pleasing people. I was worried about disappointing my parents, who at that time, I'm sure, were a little more concerned about the life of their daughter and their grandchild than me going out there and winning on Lake Kristi. But that's how warped our mind can get sometimes when we just get so driven and so focused and we think things are so important. So I ended up having that surgery and others. And for me, that was the turning point in my faith, because when I couldn't be Kristi the skier, I had to figure out who I was. And when I couldn't set world championship titles and records, I didn't feel so good about myself anymore because I felt like a nobody. It was hard for me for years after I retired. I had a big pelvic surgery, and so I had to retire from water skiing. And to even step on the side of like the U.S. Masters and to watch the other athletes go by with their flags, the flag and the boat, the opening ceremonies, and to hear that song, Stars on the Water, it would just make me feel so bad. And I would just go hide in my ministry booth and minister to people. And, you know, I thought, okay, God, you got to help me get over this. Help me get over feeling like a nobody. And that's when I turned to the Lord. I had been a Christian for many, many years, but I was not a follower of Jesus Christ. I was so afraid of where God would send me and what he would ask me to do and what I'd have to give up. Surely I'd have to give up water skiing if I became a sold-out Christian. I saw I'd be in a jungle somewhere fighting off the mosquitoes. And, you know, now I want to go to the jungle and fight off the mosquitoes. I'm really ready to go. But back then, I was afraid of that. I was afraid of God. I wanted to go to heaven, but I did not trust him with my life because I said, if I give you my life, you're going to take away everything fun. You're going to take away everything that's meaningful for me, to me. And it's just going to really stink. That was the thoughts of a teenage girl. And so I chased after everything the world would say would make you happy, but yet I was only happy when I won. I was only happy when I ran a lot of buoys. I could go to a tournament, get first place, feel great. I could go to the next weekend, ski better than I did the weekend before, but come short of winning by just a quarter of a buoy. And you skiers know what that means. That's not much, but yet I would feel like the biggest loser ever. And so during the time when I couldn't ski, I had to find out who I was, and I realized, you know what? I am a child of the living God. And it took me 15 years to finally get to a place where I am now, where I understand what that means. You know, Sheila and I earlier were talking about how we sing these songs. I grew up singing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. How do we know? The Bible tells me so. I always heard the Bible says that. The Bible says that. And I would read a little bit of the Bible. You know, every good Christian at least goes like that and reads a verse a day. That was my point and read method for many years. But when I got to that place of everything being gone that was important to me, and me finally looking and saying, okay, Lord, who am I? Why am I here? Certainly it's for something greater than water skiing, because that's gone. And those trophies, they break. And that money, I've already spent it, you know? So what is it about? And what I realized last week, I went to the World Championships there in Orlando. It's for the Senior World Championships. So these are 35 and older water skiers, 65 older, 75 and older. It is so cool. But what I realized this week is I didn't run out and hug those buoys. I ran out and hugged the people. People from all over the world. And so what this journey is with Christ, it's about people. It's about finding out who you are in Jesus Christ, where you are worth more than what you do and how much money you make and how many people like you. You are worth something because Jesus Christ says you are. And over 2,000 years ago, he said, you're worthy. Knowing everything that I'd ever do, knowing every wrong thing I'd ever think, he said, I'm going to go die for you. He says I'm worthy. He says I am worth something. He says Jesus loves me. Jesus, the Son of God, God loves me. Think about that for a minute. You have Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. And think about what that means. Jesus, who is he? He's the Son of God. Who is God? He is the creator of this whole world. I mean, you've done a great job out here, but you couldn't have done any of it unless God had made the wood and put this amazing scenery back here and these trees. And he is the sustainer of our lives. And he gives us the oxygen to breathe. He is God. And guess what? He loves you. And what does love mean? Love means it's not this I love pizza. It's this unconditional love that he has for you and me that is not based on how many buoys you run, not based on your money or your looks or how many kids you have and how perfect they turn out. God loves you because you're his kid. He loves you. Love gives. He gave his life for you because he loves you. What is love? Love is patient. God is patient with you. It's kind. It's merciful. It's filled with grace. I love it. It says that God is love, and love keeps no records of wrong. How awesome is that? And to finally get to a place that God Almighty loves me, he has so much patience with me, so much grace for me. He has... doesn't remember when I ask for forgiveness all the things that I've done wrong. He covers me with his love, and he loves me. Me, a perfectionist type A lady who stubborn. You can ask my husband and my father, just bullheaded, strong. He loves me. He loves you. You, all of us. That is not because of anything, but because we're his kid. And when I finally started to grasp that, my entire life changed. My entire view of, if we got it, if we're like, you know what, God loves me. He has good plans for me. He's not going to fail me. He's going to provide for me out of his love for me. And you get in the Word of God, this thing that so often we feel like we don't have time for, this book that I felt for years were going to zap every bit of fun that I would have in life. When I finally got in it and said, you know what, Lord, I need you because this isn't working. These buoys aren't working. I need you because people aren't working. You know, I love people, but I'm spending my whole life trying to make people happy, and I'm exhausted, and I'm tired. And God, I'm working really hard in this ministry, but I'm tired. I need your strength. And when I started realizing that there is so much more to life than just sitting in a pew and then going about our day on our own, that there is a God who loves me and will never fail me, it changed everything. It changes how I look at life. It changes. I really don't get upset as much as I used to, or as anxious as much, although it's pretty just Friday, about having a clean house. But you realize it really doesn't matter. The only thing that really matters are the people that you meet and the people that you love on and the legacy that you leave for the Lord through the things that you love. That's the keys. Through God put passions in your life. God gave you gifts and abilities. He's not trying to take them from you. He's placed some of you in incredible business positions for you to touch the world. What happens is the church goes, oh, we can't go there in that entertainment industry because there's a lot of heathens in that. There's drugs and there's alcohol. Well, maybe if we were there, there wouldn't be. The most powerful part of your testimony I have heard is where you said that there was this man standing on a soapbox and you walked by and he said, you're going to hell. And unfortunately, that's what a lot of the church does. We point our fingers and we judge and we criticize instead of coming alongside somebody, whether it's in the water, coaching them to victory, whether it's in a restaurant, encouraging somebody or serving somebody. Man, if you go over there and eat us some good food, there is a guy, Chris, the cook, he just lights up the room, flipping omelets. He lights up the room. It doesn't matter what you do, just matters that you allow God to shine through. Hey, that rhymed. Kenny, you can make a song out of that. So I, you know, this morning I had a lot of other things written down and God didn't let me say them. So I don't know if any of this made sense. I hope it did. And I just hope that it encourages your heart to come to a place. We're not so concerned about what we're doing, although doing is important. There is a world out there that needs Jesus. But coming to a place where we are just free to be who God has created us to be. And find that place of freedom and then just let him shine through you, whether it's when you're with your kids. That's the hardest place for God to shine through for me. And I'll just be honest, but I'm working on it. You know, do y'all like donuts? Okay. I knew I'd get your attention. I don't eat donuts about once a year. And we had some donuts the other day, but really my favorite place is Krispy Kreme, the Hot Now. But what I really like is if you go to the window at this one we have in Greenville, North Carolina, and there's the whole conveyor belt, and you watch it plop the dough out, and then it's like sizzling, and it's baking, and it's pounding, and then it hits the glaze of glory, the sugar. And you know, that's how I see our Christian walk. Some of us are clumps of dough that has just been plopped out. We've just made this decision for Christ. Some of us have fallen off the conveyor belt. know, we're like this, you know, we've just kind of doing our own thing. God wants you back on the conveyor belt. Some of us, I feel like I'm at a half-baked stage. You know, I am learning. I am becoming a little bit more like him each day. I'm not there yet. I have a long ways to go. You can ask this man later. Long ways to go. But I'm headed towards that glaze of glory. And that's all God asks, is that you get back on the conveyor belt. You just keep going. You let him continue to make and mold you using the things that he's gifted you with. Having your purpose in life based on him and your worth based on him and not what you do. Tapping into his strength so you don't wear yourself out. And you will accomplish the impossible. Accomplish the impossible. If you would, just bow your heads. Did Mr. Kent, there you are. While your eyes are closed, I am going to just sing one song here. It is one of my favorites, and it's I'd Rather Have Jesus. And it's an old hymn, and it just talks about coming to a place in your life where you'd rather have him than anything, whether it's riches, whether it's wealth and fame or traveling the world, where your greatest desire is to know him and be used by him so that you can come to that place of freedom and that place of impact and leaving a legacy for what truly matters. And as I sing this, if you'll just find a place in your heart where you're just you and God, and just think about the things that are going on in your life, and are you tapped into a power source that will never fail you? Are you allowing him to take you on this journey that is going to be greater than you could ever imagine? Or are you resisting him because you're afraid to let go? If you'll just picture my ski picture, when you let go, the most amazing things can happen. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than him. This world affords to take. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have my Jesus than all fortune or fame. I'd rather be true to him. Of a vast
this world affords today.
As Christians are praying and your head is bowed and your eyes are closed, we'd like to give you an invitation. We'd like to invite you to come forward today and receive Christ as your Savior if you haven't done that. It's the first item of business that needs to be taken care of today. You heard Kristi, her wonderful story and testimony. It reminds me of the young man who was walking down the road and was going back home. And he had been out in the world. He'd been out doing all these things that he shouldn't be doing. And he had spent his inheritance. And in shame, he was on his way back home to his father. I'm sure he was thinking as he was walking down that road, oh, he's going to be so mad at me. And yet when his father saw him, his father was looking for him, hoping that he would return. And when he saw him, he ran to meet him. And before the young man could even say, I'm sorry, he had him up in his arms and he was dancing and said, son, welcome home. Welcome home. And this morning, your Heavenly Father is looking for you. He's waiting for you with his arms outstretched, and he wants to welcome you. Welcome you home if you haven't. If you've been out, running around, you've been out doing these things in the world, and you feel this emptiness inside. God, that's an emptiness that only He can fill. Let's all stand together as we remain in an attitude of prayer. And as we sing this song, you come. If you want to accept Christ, Bob will be down here, Joni down front. If you have a need for prayer, for anything, for any reason at all, you need to come forward. Let us pray with you this morning. Then to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. Pray that you will continue to draw them by your Holy Spirit. You'll just continue to work on them, Lord. The seed's been planted today. And Lord, harvest that seed through someone. That this person who received the message this morning that needed you and didn't come forward, that they will come forward. And they will accept you. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Okay. Kristi, that was wonderful. Praise God. There's just something about her delivery. I mean, I just felt like she was my sister or something, you know. She is in the Lord, but I mean, just felt like family, you know. She's just got such a sweet personality, and she loves Jesus. And we're going to ask Sheila Doyle if she would come up and get ready to sing for us, as we're going to now receive the offering. Could the ushers come forward? It's really important. This is an important part of our service. Folks, if you want to receive, give, because God will bless you. He really will. You know, for years, I never tithed, and I was always broke. I was looking for money. I was always borrowing money from people and in debt. And I started tithing in 2003, and I've been tithing ever since. And you know what? I've never been broke since. And God has always supplied my needs. He will supply your needs. So let's go to the Lord to bless the gift and giver today. Mark, would you do that for us? Thank you. Appreciate it. Would you pray for our gift and the gift? Yeah.
Father, we just thank you so much for your love for us. And we know that all of these gifts, as Kristi said, all of them come from you. It's our hope that we will be able to use them for your glory. We just ask you to bless this offering for everybody here this morning. Jesus. Thank you.
wonderful to be in the house of God this morning. Amen. To offer up praise to Him, to glorify His name. Hallelujah. The same thing kept going from beginning when Charlie spoke, Bob, Kristi. I can do all things through Christ. Amen? We can do all things. And God has made us all champions. But we have to come together and learn what He has for us, study the Word of God. And every Sunday we have Bible study over across the street in the gathering hall, that you can come together for Sunday school and learn about the Word of God, learn how to be a champion, learn how to overcome the things that are sent against you. Because as she was saying earlier, you have to know the Word of God. You have to know what God says about you and for you. And He says you're a champion, and we have to learn how to walk according to the Word of God. October 26th, Paul Williamson is going to be sharing his testimony. If you haven't heard it, you've got to come hear it. It is a miraculous testimony, and it will encourage you that God is in the miracle working business, and He's here for you. The November 9th is our special worldwide service for November. You can study the bio in the bulletin, but we have Veretta Heidelberg, and she is an outstanding musician, plays the saxophone, flute, sings with a lovely Latin jazz soothing voice, and you want to come hear her. Honey Lake Church, we have a website that you can see what's happening, look at our events. Also, the second Sunday is videotaped. You can go online and watch those again at honeylakechurch.com. Bob mentioned the Jesus Alliance. There's a movement that he has started, and many, many Christians have come on board with it. We need everyone who believes in the name of Jesus Christ, who believes in the morals of the Bible, to come together and be unified. It's not a matter of whether you dunk or sprinkle or any of that stuff. It's a matter, do you believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God, died for your sins, ascended into heaven, and sits at the throne of God? If you believe Jesus Christ is your Savior and your Lord, then we're asking you to go to JesusAlliance.org and to sign up, because we need to unify as the body of Christ to make a change in our nation. It won't be done if you sit back. God told us to occupy. Jesus said we are to occupy this land. And for too long, we've sat back and done nothing. And we need to stand together. Honey Lake Church, we have a prison ministry, a local prison ministry. See Kenny if you'd like to be involved with that. Drama team. We also have a sheet back there to sign up for baptism if you haven't been baptized. The third Sunday of each month, we have a youth meeting at the pavilion at 6 p.m. And the next one is October 19th. Prayer requests. There's a green book in the back to sign up for prayer requests. And also, maybe you just didn't feel like coming down front when the invitation was given. Grab Bob or myself or one of us. We'll be glad to pray with you. If you have a concern, if you have a need that you just need us to pray with you, we're here as the body of Christ to stand together, to join together, to be here for one another. And one way we can do that in fellowship is across the street at the Sunday brunch. If you take today's bulletin, you get a discount. There's a fabulous buffet every week, but on the second Sunday, it is a blowout buffet if you haven't been there. And so it's a good time to fellowship together and break bread together. Well, I know that there were a lot of nuggets shared today, so I know each person received something special because Kristi just shared a lot of truths. And I just believe that you're going to think about the things she said this week and that God is going to help you apply it to your life. Amen? Well, let's stand together before we dismiss. Oh, I forgot. I'm glad you remind me. Kristi has several materials in the back. She has a devotional book. She has a periodical that comes out quarterly. She has a book, and she's standing back there and be glad to talk with you. And she does this just for a donation. So bless her today. You know, when you sow your seed into a good ministry, it will come back to you. God will bless you. And as though you were going with her when she goes to these different places to share, when you bless her and her ministry. Amen. All right, Father God, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus, and we just thank you, first of all, for this opportunity to come together to worship you, to thank you for dying for us, to learn more about you and how to have you in our life. I thank you for the truths that were shared this morning. I thank you that as we go about this week, that you will help us to remember those things that were spoken and how to apply them into our lives. Father God, it says that you created us. You made a plan for us. It says, I know the plans that I have for you, plans to prosper, plans for a future. So, Father God, help us to know that you have a plan for us, that we are all to be champions in Jesus Christ, that we're all to be overcomers through the blood of Jesus Christ. And I thank you, Father God, that our steps are ordered and that we'll walk in and fulfill that plan for you have that you have for us, and we'll return safely again to worship together in Jesus' mighty name. And the people said, amen. Amen. Be blessed this week. Have a great week. So glad you came and worshiped with us today.